Hi, Pastor Bob. We are so blessed you've decided to dig into the fruit of the Active Word Broadcast Ministry. Now, of course, it's our heart and it's our hope to help you grow in the knowledge and understanding of who Jesus is and how he wants to work in your life. If, in fact, we're successful, would you be so kind? Drop us a line, make a phone call. And if, in fact, there's a way we can serve you better, we'll know this. It's our goal. God bless you.
Have a seat. Tu sublime amor. Señor, rodéame con tu amor. Tu sublime amor. Tu sublime amor. Tu sublime amor.
Like a light. Father, this day, today, we give you thanks for your word. You have given to us a guide. There are ground rules for great living. There are limitations provided with boundaries that can be a blessing to those who choose to follow. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for caring enough for your children that we would hold in our hand an instruction manual that promises to bless the life of those who live by it. Thank you, God, for thinking so much of us that today, in this short span of time, we call yours, that we would hear your voice, that we would heed that voice, and our lives would be forever changed. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Watch your step. Watch your step. Watch your step? Yeah. We've all seen that three-word phrase. It is, of course, at the entrance, at the exit, the doorway, the stairwell. It's at the threshold. Why? Well, there is that hope to help. Somebody doesn't want to see you stumble or spill, trip or topple, fall or falter. Of course. Watch your step. It's that same spirit Solomon employs. Ecclesiastes chapter 5 in verse 1. Walk prudently when you go to the house of God, and draw near to hear rather than to give the sacrifice of fools. For they do not know that they do evil. Again, verse 1, walk prudently when. Well, that's the way the New King James reads it. But those of you that take notes, Children's Translation, well, it reads this way, be careful when. The New International Version translation reads, guard your steps. The King James Version Bible, keep thy foot. And God's Word translation, well, that's where you'll find, watch your step. Watch your step. Watch your step. The point? Well, the point is a matter of place. Watching your step, you must know where you are. And I want to say, again, for those of you that take note, the first of five, yeah, we need to watch our place, our place, our place. Do you know you're in church? You say, Bob, that's obvious. Of course, I know where I am. No, no, no. Let me remind you or reinforce this fact. Right now, you are in the house of God. That should give it a little more meaning. The house of God. Yeah, this is the house of God. This is the word of God. The spirit of God is here to take this messenger with my mouth and move. And your heart, if in fact you know where you are, your heart will be changed. Not because it's a few verses and Bob Coy. No, if that's all it is, I wouldn't come back. But if in fact it is what he says it should be, the Bible, and the Spirit of God moving through words to bring some? Well, to some there'll be a sense of repentance. You will actually change your way of thinking. For others, there'll be a breaking down of a position, could be pride. I don't know, but I am certain he does. Exactly where you're at even now. So if in fact you're in the house of God, if his word by his spirit moving through the messenger's mouth, and now he has something he wants to say to you, how dare anyone interrupt the flow of communication if in fact God is hoping to say something to someone in such great need? Now, understand, this pastor can from time to time be bothered or bugged, even burdened by those distractions, those interruptions. You've heard me say in the past, and sometimes I'm even borderline rude. Your cell phone in the house of God? Not now. Please, 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 turn it off. Don't be that distractive. Or a late arrival. Somebody's just now coming in. And as you come in, I watch everyone's head turn in your direction because you have no sense of timing. Church service, this service starts at 12:30. Right now it happens to be 1:05. If you're coming into the house of God right now, you're over a half hour late for your time in God's house. You go, Bob, I brought a friend. You sound so serious. I am. You need to understand whether it's a cell phone or a late arrival or some four-year child you feel needs to be in the house of God. Oh, I've heard people say, I brought my friends, they have kids, we can sit in the sanctuary. No, really, we don't allow kids under 12 in the sanctuary. I can't believe you don't allow kids in the sanctuary. Don't you know Jesus said, suffer not the children to come unto him. I can't believe Pastor Bob's dividing families. Is that really what I'm doing, dividing families, because I don't like kids in the sanctuary? No. You see, I'm aware of what a distraction is to the heart of God. Oh, it's not just the Ecclesiastes 5:1. Watch your step. Watch your place. You're in the house of God. No. Keep your place in Ecclesiastes 5. Go with me, Leviticus chapter 10. Leviticus 10. And in verse 1, we read, then Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, each took his censer and put fire in it, put incense on it, and offered profane fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. So fire went out from the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. And Moses said to Aaron, this is what the Lord spoke, saying, by those who come near me, I must be regarded as holy. Before all the people, I must be glorified. So Aaron held his peace. Your attention, please. Dad now of two boys that have just been executed, just been eradicated, is supposed to not weep or whine. He's not supposed to complain. He's not supposed to cry. He's holding his peace. Why? Because God judged him. God judged him. Why in the world would God judge this way? Now, for some of you, you're here for the first or second time, you're going, this is why I don't hang here well. This is your God. This is the one you love. This is the one you sing songs to. He wipes out a couple of kids in the church for doing what? Explain this, please, preacher. This kind of judgment. Well, I, as a preacher, will, of course, in the library of books I enjoy, grab some commentaries. What do scholars say? And some of them scatter at this point. Why are Nadab and Abihu so harshly judged? Some suggest, and it's a possibility, that it was the incense they offered. You see, according to Exodus chapter 30, the incense that was offered to the Lord must be holy incense. It was a mixture of herbs and spices that God had pre-prescribed. And if you didn't mix it the way he had ordered it be mixed, Bible called judgment upon you. Oh, that makes a lot of sense, Bob. They offered fragrant incense to God, and they didn't mix it right, so he killed them. Oh, I see that perfectly. Now that you explained that, I understand. Everyone should be killed for not mixing incense for God. Right. Still don't buy it. Well, then how about, as some scholars submit, it was their attitude as they approached this holy moment. Because they had this kind of ho-hum, we're just in the temple, so what? Yeah, God is here, but you know, I mean, I'm a human being, he made me. Certainly there's going to be some understanding. I mean, come on, he is a father. I mean, we're his kids. Come on now. Really? That's how we approach the Lord? And in other words, here at Calvary Chapel, since we're in casual apparel, we can also have casual approach. And nothing really has to be holy here. I mean, this is just, I mean, it's a building. Oh, come on, it's carpet. You're a human being, Bob. Don't get so arrogant. Don't lift yourself up. Put yourself on a pedestal. This is just you and some Bible verses. I'm not going to make it more than that. You think that's maybe the attitude they had? I don't know. What do you think? I think what we really need to do is look at this section of Scripture in context. How's that? Well, you can pull it out of context and in many ways read your own opinion. But on the other hand, in context, you might see why it would be God appearing so judgmental. It's chapter 9, verse 22. Let's follow the flow. Then Aaron lifted his hand toward the people, blessed them, came down from the offering, the sin offering, the burnt offering, and peace offerings. And Moses and Aaron went into the tabernacle of meeting and came out and blessed the people. Then the glory of the Lord appeared to all the people, and fire came out from before the Lord and consumed the burnt offering, the fat on the altar. And when all the people saw it, they shouted and fell on their faces. Then, your attention, please. You see, it was a very, very holy moment. It was the kind of moment where, if you will, the practical presence of God cannot be denied. He showed up. God showed up. There was a sacrifice representing the sins of the people on the altar. A fire comes down from heaven, consumes the sacrifice. The people look on. He is holy. He is Lord of lords, King of kings. Who are we to be in his presence? They get on their faces. I am certain in this crowd there would be the automatic natural breaking of the heart. Who am I to stand in front of a holy God? And while everyone is in that silent sorrow, repentance that's real, Nadab and Abihu, think it's time to do incense. Want to do incense? I don't know. Want to do incense? All right, let's do incense. I'm putting it in the sanctuary. Time for incense. And God sees that and says, out! Boom! Moses says, don't say anything. Is that the problem? Maybe we need a little more. Chapter 10 and verse 4. Then Moses called Mishael and Eliphaz, the sons of Uzziel, the uncle of Aaron, and said to them, come near and carry your brethren from before the sanctuary out of the camp. So they went near and carried them by their tunics out of the camp, as Moses had said. And Moses said to Aaron and to Eleazar and to Ithamar, his sons, do not uncover your heads nor tear your clothes, lest you die and the wrath come upon all people. But let your brethren, the whole house of Israel, bewail the burning which the Lord has kindled. You shall not go out from the door of the tabernacle of meeting, lest you die. For the anointing oil of the Lord is upon you. And they did according to the word of Moses. Then the Lord spoke to Aaron, saying, do not drink wine or intoxicating drink, you nor your sons with you, when you go into the tabernacle of meeting, lest you die. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations, that you may, watch this, here's the key, distinguish between holy and unholy, between unclean and clean, that you may teach the children of Israel all the statutes which the Lord has spoken to them by the hand of Moses. Now I understand. What's that? Some scholars suggest little alcoholic consumption. And because they've lost the sense, the spiritual sense, what is right and what is wrong, what is holy, what is unholy, in one of the more holy moments, as they come in somewhat tipsy, oh, certainly cavalier, time for incense burning, here we are. God says, you know what? That's not going to go down in my house that way anymore. Out you go. Aaron, don't say a word. Your kids deserve judgment. Bob, what's the lesson to us? I mean, it's Calvary Chapel. It's the New Testament time. And aren't we under grace? I mean, come on now. What are you saying? Here's what I'm saying. I have a sense of humor, but I also have a sense of holy. I have a desire to relate, but I have a desire to relate righteousness. And yet I think that there's a tendency every once in a while for me to have to say what you need to hear me say, and that is that this time is unlike any other time. This is not the time to sleep or slumber. This is not the time to chat or to gab or to yak. This is the time you come to the house of God. The minute you cross that threshold, you go, watch my step. This is holy is what it's supposed to be. Holy. Now, what does that mean? Let me lovingly say what it means is that every once in a while, I'll even say something I really don't want to say that he's telling me to say that I have to be obedient in saying. I'm a really nice guy. I don't care when you come. I mean, come on. It's just show up 10 minutes late. I mean, I guess that's okay. No. You see, you'd love to see the friendly side of an understanding pastor say, hey, you know what? A lot of grace here. I'm really glad you're here. But there's the spiritual side of this man of God that would say, how dare you? How dare you? Why? Is there anybody else you do that to? Show up so late for? I mean, sincerely, let me just ask in a more practical way. Football game. You show up late? You show up a half hour after the kickoff? No. Here's what we do in South Florida. We show up 2 hours early for a football game. It's called a tailgate party. And people actually show up in the parking lot, and they bring their lawn chairs and a big screen television. They bring all their drinks and beverages, a cooler. They throw a ball back and forth because they would never be late for kickoff time. Would you ever do that to your boss? Wander in tomorrow at work the way you wandered in today. Church started at 12:30. So show up. Tomorrow morning you're supposed to be at work. Show up around 8:35 and just walk in. Just go, hey. And here's what's going to happen. Your boss is going to look at his watch and say, do you know what time you're supposed to be here? I know, but you ever seen the parking here? Here's what your boss would say to you. Don't do that again. You won't last. Don't do that again. You won't. That's what he'd say to you. Kids in the sanctuary. Again, I've had people email me from time to time. I can't believe you don't allow kids in the church. If this is really what it's supposed to be, God Almighty wants to talk to you, how much do you think that ought to be interrupted? What if you worked for some company, some corporation, and now the CEO says, hey, I got a big meeting. I want all of my big suit guys to show up tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Now, here's what you do. Not only do you show up late, but you show up carrying your 4-year-old. And you look at the CEO and you go, you don't mind if he colors while you talk? You don't mind, do you? He's just going to sit there and color. And the kids get some crayons. He starts to spread them out and he starts to kind of spin around like that. He looks up at everybody. You've got leadership, a part of your team, that are aghast at your attitude. Are you serious? You'd bring your 4-year-old to a meeting where the head honcho is supposed to speak? You must be out of your mind. You go, but Bob, I mean, even babies, you don't allow babies in the church. We do allow a lot of babies in the church, just not here in this setting, and I'll tell you why. You got a new baby? Oh, I love new babies. You put that new baby on your shoulder and start to pat its back. And what's happening on the other side? You think your baby's not a distraction. Why? It's right here. Just right here, right next to me. But there's a little cherub face on your shoulder that's now looking at a mom and dad, and it's caught mom's heart. Look. Why? Because there's this little bubble that's starting to grow. You just got burped, and now air is just expanding. Look, honey, look at the bubble. And it's not just the mom and dad that are behind the woman with the baby on her back. No, it's about 15 people I've seen lose my attention span completely while we wait for a bubble to pop on your baby. The bubble pops, the little kid's eyes blink, and everyone's laughing right behind the mom that has no clue as to what just happened. If this is really what it's supposed to be, quite honestly, I would want to come early.
Well, I don't know. Come early. You know, no parking out here.
Do you know that at 12 o'clock till 10, there's no one here. There's nobody in the parking lot from 10 to 12 until 10 after 12. Even quarter after 12. Even 20 after 12. You all don't show up until 25 after 12 for the 12:30 service. You all show up 5 minutes till. Just thinking that you're... You go, Bob, I still can't believe how heavy this is to you. So you want to have the reputation that church starts at. What do you think you're doing to the worship team? I mean, I would, out of respect to people who have practiced songs for a really long time, at least want to hear their first tune. But Bob, not everybody is in that position. I mean, there's a few stragglers that come in late. Hey, we watched how many cars came in after 12:30 today. You want to just confess? There's another form of judgment, if you will. You say, Bob, that's not funny. No, you know what? It's not. It's not. And I really sense that God wanted me to say to you, and I really mean this sincerely, he's my witness, quit showing up so late for church. Why? It says something not just to the people who are here that are prepared, that are waiting to minister to you. But it says something, even to your friends. It's just an attitude. It's an approach to God that says, you know what, I'm going to the house of God, and I'm going to make sure the apparel of my heart has been properly arrayed, that here in his house, I won't even get quiet before the worship song starts. Why? If I'm quiet before the worship song starts, when it starts, I'm going to be in tune with everything that's happened, and by the time the Bible study starts, my heart will be prepared to receive the word. Why? God really wants to say something every week here. And I'm convinced that if you just prepare your heart before you show up with that sense of, you know what, I'm going to the house of God. I'm going to the house of God. And the minute you walk past the door, I am now in the house of God. And I've come 5 minutes early to get my favorite seat. And now that I'm in my favorite spot, I'm just going to just dwell on. And what happens? Now the song starts. Worship was never richer for you. The Bible study never so profound. Why? Because it was an attitude that you approached him with. You didn't do what the Bible suggests that you shouldn't do. And that, of course, in Ecclesiastes 5, is just kind of come in and draw near to, well, you didn't draw near to hear, you came to offer the sacrifice of fools. No, he says, hey, watch your place. But the second thing he says now in verse 2 is this, do not be rash with your mouth, do not let your heart utter anything hastily before God, for God is in heaven and you're on earth, therefore let your words be few. For a dream comes through much activity, and a fool's voice is known by his many words. If you're a note taker, watch your prayers. Watch your prayers. Bob, I don't know what you had for breakfast this morning. Evidently, it was a glass of judgment and a bowl of ridicule. I mean, how far are you going to take us today? First, you're down on us for when we show up, and now you're going to tell me my prayers are bad? I pray bad prayers? Yeah. What do you mean? I'm saying according to his word, there are some prayers and an attitude in prayer you shouldn't have. You got to watch those prayers. Watch my prayers. Keep your place in Ecclesiastes. It's Matthew chapter 6, drawing your attention to verse 5. Jesus is speaking. When you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets, that they might be seen by men. Now watch this. Surely I say to you, they have their reward. Now what is he saying? He's saying if you're praying just for a show, guess what? It's a show that man will recognize that I will not acknowledge. That's your reward. You just got it. The applause and the appearance of being spiritual before men, that's it. Da-da. Done. So that's it? You mean to tell me when I'm at a restaurant after the church service and I want to play Joe spiritual and impress a few of my single sisters? I'll say the prayer. Gracious God, we beseech thee. Using King James Version English, approaching him like it's a show, like you're performing. I'm sorry, he says, that is your answer. You did your prayer for a show, so you got your show. I really don't have anything to do with it. Really? I'll move a little further. It gets worse than that. Watch this. Verse 6. But you, when you pray, go into your room. And when you've shut your door, pray to your Father who is in a secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, do not use vain repetition as the heathen do. Watch this. For they think that they will be heard for their many words. They think they're going to be heard. Now the implication is obvious. They're not being heard by me. They think they're being heard, but they're not being heard. He says this, don't be like them, verse 8, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. In this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You got a pencil handy circular word for hallowed? Venerate, consecrate, purify. And here's the idea behind this kind of prayerful heart. Check it out. Before you pray, you're actually going to think about what you're praying. Sounds novel, doesn't it? What do you mean? I think too often in life, we just come to God with this rote routine kind of prayer life. You know the Lord's Prayer, right? I know the Lord's Prayer. Everybody knows the Lord's Prayer. And we pray it. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. I remember a kid growing up. It was the one prayer we memorized as a family. All the boys, all the girls, we all knew that prayer. So Dad would holler from downstairs up to the bedroom. Hey, boys, you say your prayers? Not yet. We are right now.
Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
While you're brushing your teeth? Well, I bet the Father is really blessed by that. I bet he's going, oh, man, that's touching my heart. While you're brushing, you can pray. Oh, that's exciting. Join the circus. What? You say, Bob, you said it before, but I'm going to capitalize on this. He's a father. We're his kids. What if we just want to pour out our heart? It's one thing if you are pouring out your heart. I'm sure he hears that. But I believe that in light of the context of the verse we just read, don't be rash, don't be hasty. What's that? Too many of our prayers are on the run. Too many of our prayers are not from the heart. Too many of our prayers are from the head. I'm saying don't pray that. Watch your prayers. Why? Here's why. You ever say you love your wife on the run? Where it's almost a routine. Yeah, I love you too. Okay, bye-bye. I love you, babe, bye. Oh, touching. It's not. Why? You're just saying it because it's the thing you're supposed to say. How many times I've been around fellow pastors who are talking to their wives on the phone, and they know, as a pastor, looking at a pastor, you have to close by saying, I love you, honey. I love you. It's my wife. Yeah, I love you, honey. Okay, love you, but all forced, all feigned. I love saying, I love you to my wife, but I've found there are more effective ways to do that. One of those ways, we have this construction kid cabinet. It's got construction paper, it's got glitter, it's got glue, it's got sparkles, it's got pipe cleaners, everything imaginable to make anything you want to. I have found if I spend 10 minutes in that cabinet putting together something for my bride, oh, I know how to take red paper, fold it quickly. I know how to take white. I can make a heart so fast. I stick it on the front, and now I open it up. Dear Diane, and that's when it's so tough for all of us guys. It's that way we go, I don't know what even to say. That's why Hallmark, an American greeting, is in existence, isn't it? I don't know what to say. I got to find a card.
Oh, that's what it is. That's what I want to say right there. That's what I'll say. Hey, babe.
And she reads it, oh, where'd this come from? The store. She checks the back. Discount. Okay. You price a card lately? Do you have any idea how expensive cards is? I don't can't believe they get $5, $10 for a card. My books don't sell for that. I mean, it's just amazing to me. For a card. So here's what you do. You know, no. I'm not going to rely upon Hallmark or American Greeting. I'm going to write it myself. And here's what happens. You don't know what to say.
Dear, know her wife, name's Diane.
Now, for me, I have a little pet name, and she has a little pet name for me, so I'll write, dear, and I'm not going to tell you what it is. And then out from my heart it flows. And what happens? Well, here's what happens. From my heart it flows, from my heart it goes. She opens it up, she starts to read it. Where did you get this?
It's me, babe.
Well, thank you very much. Listen, she'll keep that. She'll put it on the nightstand. And if it's on the nightstand, it will be saying something to her right in our room. Wow, wait, you guys are taking that way too far. I'm a pat. Hey. You ever think about writing a letter to God and tell him how you feel? What do you mean? What would it be like if someday this week you sat down and said, dear God, and just begin to tell him what you appreciate about his spirit working in your life? Mark my words, you won't get halfway through the page, but that you don't find some emotion welling up inside of you. You might tear stain that paper. Why? You try and tell God how you feel in paper form? Do you understand that that's why we have the Psalms? That it's David saying, I got to tell you how much I love you. And I want to put it, I'm going to write this out. How majestic is your name. How awesome is your, oh, your creation. God, your handiwork. And what happens? We take those songs, we take those letters, we put them to music, they touch our hearts, they change our perspective. What is that? That's a man talking to his God about his character and his need. Watch your prayers. Sometimes we're just way too fast, and sometimes it's such rote routine experience and expression, it seems to be void of any relationship. You could not get away with that same behavior with anyone else here on planet Earth, save after the fact you feel like there's a strain in the relationship. So please, watch your prayers. Watch your place. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, now pick it up with me in verse... Well, it's verse 4, we read... And when you make a vow to God, do not delay to pay it. For he has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you vowed. Better not to vow than to vow and not pay. Don't let your mouth cause your flesh to sin. Or say to the messenger of God, it was an error or a mistake in a newer translation. Why should God be angry at your excuse and destroy the work of your hands? Watch your promises. Watch your promises. Why? I want you to write down a couple of verses, and I think this is going to help. 2 Corinthians 1 and 20. All the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. Okay? We have a God whose relationship to us is based upon promises. And all of the promises to Israel, all the goods we get because of the sacrifice of his son. Now, 2 Corinthians 7 and 1. Therefore, because of these great promises, we should cleanse our flesh from any filthiness and keep pure our spirit. Now, let's connect this finally in this subsection. 2 Corinthians 5 and 20. I am, you are, an ambassador of Christ. An ambassador of Christ. Now, when you put all that together in a mix, here's what you find. God is someone who we're counting on to be a man of his word. And because we're counting on him being a man of his word, we realize how important it is to be people of our word. In the representation of his reputation, every time we compromise where there should be a conviction kept, we are staining our Savior with a sense the watching world says is not respectable, nor is it trustworthy. Christian, I have a hard time keeping promises. Here's why. My promise to meet with someone next week, I realize, is under the authority of God. He may put me in a set of circumstances wherein after the fact, I have a hard time keeping my promise. I say to you, hey, I'll meet you for lunch next week, 12 o'clock. And what ends up happening? Well, some tragedy, some calamity in someone's life, there's a need. I call you, hey, I can't make lunch, here's why. I got something happening at the church. This thing is a great need. I must see our opportunity. Can you wait?
Oh, man, Corey didn't keep his promise.
Something outside of my control. Something outside of my authority, man. I mean, We have some friends right now. We have been trying to get together with them for dessert. We've missed two opportunities. We're now waiting for the third opportunity, but we might have to change that. Now, what is that all about? Things outside of my control. So here's what I've learned to do. Listen, here's the key. The key is don't make any promises. When you're standing up here, bride and groom, the vow needs to sound something like this. I promise to be your faithful husband unless someone more attractive, someone who I sense is much more my soulmate comes along. Okay? Here's how you do a mortgage. You look at the lender, Bank of America. I promise to pay this mortgage unless... Unless I just find there's some months I'm a little shy, and then I'll do my best to give you half. Here's how you do a car deal. I promise to make my payment, but if I don't, I need forgiveness. Because I'm a Christian, and as Christians, we understand how important forgiveness is. So I'm hoping you'll show me forgiveness, because I just might be the agent God uses to teach it to you. No. 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 Now, here's what God's suggesting to us. Here's what he's commanding us to do. Make promises you can cash. Make promises you're willing to keep. If you think you're going to stand in front of her relatives and your heavenly father and say, hey, if things don't work out the way that I think they should, maybe somebody else, you know, don't make the promise in the first place. Why? It's his reputation. It's his reputation. And if he is supposed to be somebody who keeps his word, and we're all counting on it, he would love you to be that best representation of it. Oh, imagine we are all counting on eternal life. I'm counting on getting to heaven. Imagine finally dying and getting up there, and there's Peter at the gate with a close sign. And I go, Pete, what happened to heaven? I changed his mind just about 10 minutes ago. I'm really so sorry. What do you mean? Yeah, from now on, everyone's down. Nobody gets to stay up. I'm sorry, you didn't make it. He said, hey, I appreciate all the hard work, though. I love everything you did at that church. That was pretty cool. He wanted me to tell you that. But nobody else is staying up. He says, I'm full. I don't want to do any more heaven. Everybody goes down. No! I'm living a life expecting heaven based upon the promise of his word. Is there somebody living right now, looking at your life, expecting, as you're a person of promise, they're a person of promise, and everybody's going to keep their promises? It's a wonderful thing, and I love the day where you could just shake somebody's hand and say, here's my commitment to you. I'm shaking. Let's shake on it. We shake on it. All right, now you'll do what you promised. I'll do it. Here's my word. This is my bond. Shake. I love that. Not anymore. Why don't you have your attorney call my attorney? They can meet. Put some papers together. So that when I bought my last house, I had to sign a piece of paper that was me promising I was who I am. That's what the girl said. She goes, sign that. I said, what's this? She goes, just saying you are who you are. Yeah. Me saying it's not enough, I got to write it down. She goes, yeah. I said, why? I am who I am. What if I'm lying and I write it down that I say I am and I'm still not? Oh, now we have documentation. That makes a difference? Yeah, now we have something to sue you with. Guess I'm signing. I am who I am. Ah. Is that embarrassing or what? Of course it is. Please, 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 when you say you're going to show up for work and you don't show up for work, you're affecting this thing called our Christian witness. When you don't pay your bills, you're affecting this thing called Christian witness. Please do not put a cross or a dove on your check if it's going to bounce. Bouncing doves. It irks me to no end. The accounting department at our church returning a check for non-sufficient payment of funds. Now, I realize some of you are moving by faith. Yeah. It will be there. It will be there. It will be there. Don't do that. No bouncing doves or crashing crosses. Watch your promises. And then he says this, verse 8, if you see the oppression of the poor and the violent perversion of justice and righteousness in a province, do not marvel at that matter. For a high official watches over a high official, and higher officials are over them. Moreover, the profit of the land is for all. Even the king is served from the field. He who loves silver will not be satisfied with silver, nor he who loves an abundance with increase. This is also vanity. When goods increase, they increase who eat them. So what profit have the owners except to see them with their eyes? The sleep of a laboring man is sweet, whether he eats little or much, but the abundance of the rich will not permit him to sleep. This is a severe evil which I've seen under the sun. Riches are kept for their owner to his hurt, but those riches perish through misfortune. When he begets a son, there's nothing in his hand. He came from his mother's womb, naked he shall return, to go as he came. He shall take nothing from his labor, which he can carry away in his hand. This is also a severe evil. Just exactly as he came, so shall he go. And what profit has he who has labored for the wind? All his days he also eats in darkness, and he has much sorrow, sickness, and anger. Your attention, please. Watch your priorities. Priorities. The word priority, I checked the synonyms. Important, significant, primary. In other words, if something's supposed to be first, then it is first. If it's supposed to be first and it's second, your priorities are wrong. I'm supposed to put God first in my life. Second's supposed to come my family. Third's supposed to come my ministry. And after that, now some of you would put God first, then your family, then your business, then your ministry. For some of you, your business is more important than your ministry because you're not full-time working for a church. I have to put God first, then my family, and then my ministry. Now, pastors are, I think, known for many times getting all those mixed up. And it's the ministry first. And then it's God after that. And then it's their family after that. And they grew up with some warped kids who say, Daddy, you spent a lot more time at church than you ever did at home. I'm not going to let my kids get away with that. I've tried to live a balanced life and have and maintain proper priorities. What does it mean to you, priorities? He says, here's the problem. And you have to recount this. And I'm going to ask you to go back and meditate on chapter 5, specifically starting in verse 8. Why? He says this. You'll see oppression in the land. And you have to realize, somebody else sees that's in charge. There's somebody that oversees that area of life, and they are overseen by somebody else, and somebody else oversees them, and no one's doing anything about it. Here's the amazing thing. While no one's doing anything about the oppressive things that happen on the planet, there are other very well-to-do people that can't get satisfied because the capacity with which to be satisfied is the same amount for everyone. What do you mean? If you sit down at a big feast today, your stomach's only so big. And once you're full, you're full. If you try and stuff yourself more than that, you're going to end up with a bellyache. So whether or not you have an entire table of food or a perfectly proportioned meal, your level of satisfaction is the same. He says, well, check it out. In many ways, it's the same when it comes to income and expense. Somebody has a lot of money. You can only spend so much money and be satisfied for self. He said, after that, you're going to find, even though you have a lot, you can't even enjoy all that you have. All you're going to do is see it, but you won't use it. Why? Well, because you already have enough, and enough is enough. Priority? Jot it down. It's Matthew 6 and 33. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. You see, what Solomon sees is sad. He says there are some people that have so much money, they're going to die, and when they got, they can't take it with them. Some people have a lot of money, they'll invest it in a risky adventure. He says they won't have enough. Their kid's going to come around and say, Dad, you have any money? He goes, I blew it in an investment. He says, well, they can't give it to their kids, they can't take it with them, but that's where their priorities are. He says it's sad because that priority of having stuff still won't satisfy. Priorities? His name is J.D. Rockefeller. He was then the wealthiest. Listen to this. Over a 40-year period, Rockefeller built Standard Oil into the largest and most profitable company in the world and was for a time the richest man in the world. If you don't know this, Rockefeller was the first billionaire. In 1910, Rockefeller's net worth was equal to nearly 2.5% of the whole U.S. economy, the equivalent, listen, of nearly $310 billion in today's terms. How much money is that? That's twice as much money as Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, and Sam Walton's fortunes combined. That's a lot of money. And according to this same encyclopedia article, that's not a Christian encyclopedia, he tithed from his first paycheck till the day he died. But here's what happened. He's in his late 40s. And he's getting weird, kind of like Howard Hughes. He's eating crackers and drinking small glasses of milk, and his body's beginning to just kind of fade away. He has a financial advisor that gives him this advice. J.D., you've got to start giving your money away. Really? You got too much. Well, he's being faithful, giving away his 10%. He's got so much, though, he has to start giving it away. Check this out. The day he starts giving it away, his body starts to heal. He lives another 40, almost 50 years. He had a personal goal of living to be 100. He died 3 weeks short of that. Why? Because he was no longer a closed pipe. He became a conduit of blessing to somebody else. My priority in life must be other-centered. If you are a self-centered person, you will not enjoy life, nor will you get out of life what God has intended for you as a Christian to get from it. You're a believer. You gave your life to Christ, and in giving it to him, he's now going to want to use it. If you start taking it back, you're going to abuse the privilege he gave to you. He says, please, watch your priorities. And then finally, he says in verse 18, here's what I've seen. It's good and fitting for one to eat and drink and to enjoy the good of all his labor in which he toils under the sun all the days of his life which God gives him, for this is his heritage. As for every man to whom God has given riches and wealth and given him power to eat of it, to receive his heritage and rejoice in his labor, this is the gift of God. For he will not dwell unduly on the days of his life because, and watch this, God keeps him busy with the joy of his heart. I love that. Are you busy right now with the joy of your heart? That's the gift of God. Now, watch your place. Watch your prayers. Watch your promises. Watch your priorities. Finally, watch your pleasures. Your pleasures. What's your master passion? What's the thing that, you know, gets your juices going, you know, actually has you, you know, willing to, man, I can't wait to, what is that? I hope it's not passing. I hope it's permanent. What do you mean, Bob? Remember the movie Chariots of Fire? Eric Little is wrestling with his sister over whether or not he should be A, missionary and get out the gospel, or B, on Olympiad. And he makes this comment. It's this sentence I think is the pivot point of the entire film. He says this, talking to his sister, he says, "Sis, all I know is that God made me fast, and when I run, I feel his pleasure." I like that. Here's why. All I know is God gave me a mouth to preach. And when I'm speaking on his behalf, I feel his pleasure. Now, wasn't it for you? Some of you mommies would automatically say, hey, here's what I know. I'm a mommy, and when I'm helping my son with his spelling test, I know it's going to sound strange, because it might not even seem, you know, that important to you, but I feel God's pleasure. I feel that that's the thing I've been called to do. You could be a plumber, you could be an attorney, you could be a doctor, you could be a ditch digger, you could be a waste collector. I don't care what it is. There's something that you do because you are you. God's put this thing in your heart, and that's where you receive your joy. That's where you sense your satisfaction. If you're not doing that thing, what happens? It's like you're this triangle trying to fit into a square. I'm a round peg in a round hole right here, right now.
I love it.
I'm right where I belong right now. Round peg, round hole. I'm exactly where I'm supposed to be right now, and I'm doing exactly what I'm supposed to do. I love that for everyone. How do you get there? Now, jot it down. Revelation 4:11. We are created for his pleasure. Psalm 147, verse 11 says this, the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope for his mercy. Your pleasure is discovered when you become his pleasure, and his pleasure is yours when you're purposing to pleasure him. If you're here for your own pleasure, you're going to end up coming up short. But if you've purposed to bring him pleasure, you find your pleasure, and now you are filled with the joy from your heart that he placed there even before the foundation of the world. It's your DNA. DNA. Divine, non-negotiable agenda. He's put something inside of you that's exclusively you, and you are here for a purpose. You must fulfill that purpose. And my prayer? You see, when you understand this, here's the way it happens. You come into the house of God, and now it's with reverence and respect. Your prayers, they have substance and meaning because you realize how important it is that it's a two-way communication between you and God. You only make promises you can keep, so you really have to think them through. And because you're a person of your word, you've been able to rearrange your priorities and you have respect in the marketplace because when you say you're going to do something, and you make promises to those people who matter most. Your priorities give you a sense of balance in your life, and your pleasures are those things that you know you bless God with. Man, now you understand why it's the book Ecclesiastes. Those are some wise words from a wise guy that should we decide to heed them, we too would be wise. Amen? Father, we thank you for our time together. And as we come now to the communion table, we can't think of a better time or a better place after a message that certainly does seem to put us right where we belong. Please help us, God, to make the most out of the next few moments as we simply choose to honor you and the place that you have in and over our lives. God, we acknowledge afresh, this is holy, you are holy, and by your grace, because of Jesus, we are holy. Thank you. In Jesus' name. I'm not going to say amen because I'd love to keep an attitude of holiness, a spirit of prayer in this place. As the elements are passed and you have them in your hands, can I remind you, and I'll do it in a way that I hope you don't immediately forget. Don't eat and drink when you get it. I'm going to say it again. Don't eat and drink when you get it. And I'll say it one more time. Don't eat and drink when you get it. Hold those elements in your hand and spend some time with God. Listen to the lyrics or sing the songs. It's an act of worship. Consider and contemplate all of his goodness, all of his grace. Make this holy, this time. And then we'll come back and we'll partake together as a family. So please, don't eat and drink the minute you receive it. Your religious background, that might bring you to that experience, but we are not in a hurry. We're not in a rush to honor God with his supper. So please, hold on. We'll partake together. As the ushers and deacons pass this out, let's find ourselves with that heart of worship to God. Pastor Clay.
Yeah. The Bible declares, without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Sounds so strict and specific. You have to dig a little deeper. What does the word holy mean? Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Holiness is not prideful piety. Holiness is not an air of arrogance or an intimidating attitude that says you're right and everybody else is wrong. That's not holiness. Holiness is a spirit of separation. What you're holding in your hand is holy. It's not juice and a cracker. It's the best representation of Jesus Christ. It's His blood and His body shed and bruised for your sake. This house, it's not carpet and concrete and stucco and steel. No, you are His people, so your Father is here. And my mouth, oh, I feel so responsible. Why? We pray it's not Bob and verses, but it truly is the Spirit of the living God choosing to lead and guide our lives as we take the time to hear His heart. So my prayer is this. If in fact this house is now unlike any other house, and what you hold in your hand is unlike anything else you eat, well, now you know why. See, the Bible says that Christ in you is the hope of glory. You want to be more like Jesus, but I can't be holy without His help. So He comes alongside and He says, hey, you let me in your life, and I will make you holy. Well, Lord, please come in my life. All right, let's do this now physically. Oh, I know I'm in you spiritually, but let's do this physically. You will take elements that best represent my life. And you will eat and drink them. And as you do, in just a few seconds that follow, those elements will assimilate into your system. This blood of mine, this body of mine, will soon be coursing through your veins, beating that same blood throughout your body from your heart. I will be in you, Bobby. Christ in you, the hope of glory. I can't do Christianity without His help. I feel miserably without God by my side and in my side. And this is how we commemorate. This is how we celebrate that we want Him working with and working within. If that's your desire, if that's your hope, now you know all the more so. Go to God, just the two of you, right now. Spend that time just telling Him how thankful, how grateful. Don't make a promise you can't keep. But make the promise to keep drawing close. And He'll help you keep every promise you make. Go to the Lord, talk to Him. When you're finished with your prayer, you eat and drink. I'll do the same.
Amen.
Shall we stand? I want you to take home this promise. The Bible teaches that God loves those whom He rebukes. There will be times you'll feel the sting of the Spirit. He says, hey, don't be late for church. Think before you pray. Those kinds of things. It's because He loves you. He wants more for you out of this experience. It's one of the ways it happens. But rejoice in that fact. Know that if you felt the sting, it's His hand. And as He leads and guides you with every word, certainly the promises come to pass and you find yourself a better believer. And that's why we're here. We're in church to become better believers. Amen. There'll be brothers and sisters from the fellowship, even some members of our staff. They make themselves available every week when we come to a close. If you need prayer, don't leave this building without it. Pastor Clay.
God bless you guys. Have a great rest of your weekend. Enjoy the game.
Thanks for listening to this presentation of the Active Word, a ministry of Calvary Chapel, Fort Lauderdale, Florida. For further information about the Active Word with Pastor Bob Coy, write to us at P.O. Box 5767, Fort Lauderdale, Florida 33310, or call us at 1-877-444-WORD, or you can contact us online at activeword.org.